слышал. Good evening. This is yet another episode of Sudhir Mishra Show, and this is the 9th episode. And again, it's special because for the first time we have a woman on our show, and it took a lot of time to find a perfect person who will fit in the parameters which we have tried to set in right from the beginning. And we have got somebody who is young, who is limitless, and more importantly, somebody who comes across with a lot of humility and a complete sense of gratitude, normally not seen with this present generation. And what is most striking about her is that she, when you will talk to her, when you will interact with her, you will get that calmness, you will get that certainty, which normally is expected out of a seasoned legal professional. So I present to you Paridhi Adani, partner Cyril Amachan, for this show. Paridhi, most welcome.
Thank you very much for that extremely kind introduction. A lot to live up to with that introduction. I'm truly humbled that you've picked me to be a representative of the very strong women legal community on your show. So thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, Paridhi, you talk a lot about gratitude. You talk about in your LinkedIn post, which I have been reading, you talk about that you believe that gratitude unlocks the fullness of life. In one of your posts, you had said that. I have started doing this journey only 7-8 years back when I started really believing that gratitude is something which you do for yourself, and it prepares you for everything which you actually need or you don't need. What is your meaning of gratitude?
That's a very deep question, and thanks for that. And I think part of this has actually been a lot of the upbringing that I've had. I've seen my family sort of we've worked hard to get where we are, but at the same time, we're not going to take any of that for granted. And I think a lot of times we always stop, take stock, introspect on where we are, what we're doing, where we can go. And I think that became such a strong part of our upbringing that, you know, it became a value system we wanted to bring into the workplace as well. And I'm glad to see that the world is also moving in that direction, because as life gets complex, resources get scarce, with so many things going on that are, you know, sort of on the negative side, I think gratitude brings a certain fullness to where we are. And it's not just about saying thank you. I think it's just about with a little bit about being at peace with what you have and not really taking anything for granted.
So you travel on the highway of gratitude with your calmness, which you have. This is what I realize. Tell me one thing.
Someone is listening. I have to say that he had a very big smile when you said calm. No one calls me calm, but
no, you are calm. I had an interaction with you day before yesterday. But tell me, how did you prepare yourself? You remember your childhood. You would know that what legacy you are walking in. Your school, and when you went to government law college, you know that what your father has achieved, what your family has achieved, what is the legacy. You are somebody who has always been accustomed to pressure situations, or you love batting in 5-down, 6-down, as we put it in cricket?
So I think, again, this was a lot to do with the upbringing. We witnessed our parents sort of eating, living, breathing work, and not in a way that I would say put us off. It was quite inspiring. Every dining table used to effectively become a boardroom, and we were always encouraged to be part of those conversations, to listen, to understand. I think life for us was always, we thrived in competition, which is fine, but I think there was enough exposure and opportunity for me to fall in love with the work that I was doing. I actually spent some time doing things other than law, and I found myself getting attracted back into the profession anyway. So, you know, when they say it's in the blood, it really is sort of, it's not just that. I think the profession itself has a magnetic pull.
Yes.
I spent some time doing legal journalism, as I was sharing with you, and I tried all sorts of things, but somehow the platform that this profession provides, and with the sort of responsibility and pride of the legacy, I couldn't think of anything better to do.
So I'll tell you on this moment that I, in fact, reached out to you on LinkedIn, and I almost took it as a rejection that you will not find time. But we know the reasons. You said that you came back, and thankfully we are doing this show. One of the reasons are that I see a lot of achievers. Now, problem with achievers is that one, they don't share their stories. And the second, they don't empower others. Now, all your posts on LinkedIn, all your, whether it's about Cyril Amachan's some brilliant transaction on the corporate side or a litigation stuff or something where you feel about environment, which is something very close to your heart. I used to see a pattern that you are actually involved in it. It's not a corporate communication thing. And that really made me feel that how do you balance your life? How do you balance your timings, and you find time for that? So tell me, what is your daily routine like, Paridhi, today?
So, okay, this is, I'm not trying to give you a sort of cute, smart answer, but I think there are patterns of consistency in my routine, but I like to believe in something called everyday flexibility. No 2 days in the week are going to be the same. But I know that on a daily basis, I would like to put in a full day's work. I would like to spend time with my family. I would like to spend time with my kids. I would like to do something for myself. It should be on the health and fitness side, but it's never the case. But I think you sort of prioritize on a daily basis. I think, you know, there's some days when work's going to take priority. There's some days when the kids are going to be, you know, sort of taking up that priority. So that's sort of how I broadly balance it. On a sort of day-to-day basis, I think we have enough systems in place, and I've spent a number of years investing in that system to make sure that I can actually do all of this.
Wonderful.
So now, whether it's sort of co-opting family members or, you know, sort of bringing help to do all of this, I have a very strong team that, you know, sort of can step in whenever required. I use technology very freely. And I like to plan ahead. So balance comes from a lot of the tools I have in place.
Brilliant. But I'll come to the work-life balance part, which is attached to this question. But observed you closely, heard from people who work in the setups where you work. And it's about the calmness, how you manage your work and how you fit in with everybody else. You stand out in your own way. But what is your definition of work-life balance for lawyers, for women with children?
And I think So for me, balance. I have to say that I don't think my life is very balanced, and I would like to be more balanced on this front. But if I take it to a slightly aspirational level,
yeah,
I think till the time that you don't regret anything, until the time that you don't grudge any aspect of your life not giving you the fullness in another aspect of your life, that would count as balance for me. Mm-hmm. And it could be something different. There are a lot of people who would say, you know, work-life balance means I have too much life and not enough work. And there would be others who would say I have too much work and I'm not able to participate in my family side enough. But as long as one doesn't eat up the other, I think you can achieve that. I think for especially women with children, it's not easy to achieve this.
Yes.
Especially in a country like India, where I think childcare is still not something that's been a very thoughtful solution. Yes. I know organizations are trying to do enough, but a lot of it is just society.
Yes.
I think till the time that women get stereotyped into certain roles, the school's expectations don't change, etc., you'll still face this struggle.
Yeah.
I think, you know, unfortunately, what has happened is childcare has become like a physical location. It's not about that. It's about what do you expect a household to look like? What do you expect the time, you know, that a parent is supposed to give? How are duties, you know, sort of divided? So I think work-life balance currently, especially in the context of, you know, hybrid working and the pandemic, has taken a very different definition. And I would encourage, you know, people to take help. Don't be embarrassed to take help. Nobody's expected to do it all. I would encourage people to use technology. I would encourage people to have conversations. Don't be shy about it, because I wasn't shy and I'm able to do what I want to do because of having some uncomfortable conversations at some point in my life.
Amazing. I'll tell you why I'm going to ponder a little more about this thing. And it's a very serious conversation. When I was asking Ashima and others that how do we find the first woman on the show? And I'm going to say something which may not be politically correct, but top 25 litigation lawyers in the country. Unfortunately, I didn't find anybody in that list who will be from the other side. And there are difficulties. There are family stuff. There are children to be taken care of. There are household to be taken care of. But the fact also is that most of the law firms, including my firm, we have more women lawyers now than men. And they do beyond any expectation. They always exceed the expectations. But how long they will manage to do it, at what stage they will have a barrier. So your example, where you have a further bigger thing, as I told you that you took a very tough five wickets down kind of batting. I'll tell it why I'm saying this, because your specialization of merger acquisitions, also the fact is that one of the biggest merger you did in your personal life. And so it's very natural that you will do merger acquisition. So tell me, how do you, I want you to say a little more that it's a 30, 40s, 50s and 60s, like how Jia Modi has achieved, or how you have seen your mother or others achieve this. What are your mantras for women to continue working?
So I've been brought up in an environment where your gender did not matter. And I'm not just talking about my household. I will be pleased to say that my entire education, right up to getting my legal degree, to the time that I was working, gender did not matter. And because I have to say it was conditioned in my mind for so long that even today I don't see it as a barrier. So it starts from there. And I'm not saying it's never too late to change, but I would encourage, you know, mothers to start having these conversations young. How you're brought up will be the starting, it will be the first step into making sure that, you know, someone is fully committed to their career and don't, you know, sort of panic at the first sign of stress. As I said, I think the other mantra, if you can call it that, is sometimes it's okay to call a spade a spade. If you're seeing something unfair happening, or if you believe that it's an important time to ask for help, ask for that help. Now, that help could be sort of, you know, I need some time. I need to relook at my workload. I need a team. I need a team that understands me. You know, this matter makes me uncomfortable. Whatever it could be, it could, you know, it. If you start having these conversations, I think people will respect the transparency, and going forward, that consciousness will evolve. And I think that will at least help a lot of people stay back in the workplace. And I think overall, I think as a country, we're progressing.
Yes.
I do recognize that it's especially in the council practice, it's unfortunate that we have not generated a strong pipeline of women, but I think that will come.
It will change. I agree with you.
It will come. Technology will play a big part in this.
Yes, but on the corporate side, if I talk, of course, women are much ahead than, there the ratio completely changes. At this stage, I'll ask you something. Look, relocation from Mumbai to Ahmedabad. And I'm also telling you on a serious note that a lot of general counsels and others who find a job in Ahmedabad, who have been in Delhi or Mumbai, good companies, whether it's a pharmaceutical company or other companies, I'm not taking names, they find it difficult to adjust there. And a lot of people have lost those big opportunities. Now, you are a perfect ambassador who has adjusted to that. So give us that. See, it's all about adjustments in life. You get something which is very good about the place. You have few issues here and there. But ultimately, what is ultimately the plan? How do you live your life that you adjust to the new conditions? How do you deal with that?
So on this one, I have to thank my parents for this very deeply, and of course the family I got married into as well. But we were very young when we got married. But one thing I was very clear about, and I think my parents helped me sharpen that thinking, is I would never compare the two cities.
Yes.
I'm not going to get a Bombay in Ahmedabad, and I'm not going to get an Ahmedabad in Bombay. And yeah. I think keeping in mind that I didn't want to really think about this as there's a plan B or a plan C, or let me try it out for some time and let's see if something else works out. I think we were both committed to making it work. We had a good friend circle, and I think the factors that provide you stability in any place was all there. I actually finished my studying after getting married, and I started my career in Ahmedabad itself. So I think the city gave me what I needed. And then I didn't ever have to sort of think about ye nahi chal raha hai, wo nahi chal raha hai. So I think I got lucky as well.
Yeah.
Things worked out for me very well, and the city opened me with, welcomed me with open arms, if I can say so.
Wow, so well said. And I tell you, this
the
is
food that, here is phenomenal as well. So I have no complaints.
No, there can't be, because I have visited that place, and I was also the standing council briefly in 2007-8 when I was handling the Gir lion poaching case for the state government. Wow. And I always find it very, very lovely. But this message is for all those people, all those general counsels and all the other people who have their doubts. Paridhi has answered to them, and they can now understand. At this stage, I will actually, now you deserve to hear a very interesting poem by Amrita Pritam, because you just have talked about something, you will really love it. You will relate to it also. Aaj maine apne ghar ka number mitaya hai, aur gali ke maathe par laga gali ka naam hataya hai. और हर सड़क की दिशा का नाम पोछ दिया है, पर अगर आपको मुझे जरूर पाना है तो हर देश के हर शहर की हर गली का द्वार खटखटाओ. यह एक श्राप है, यह एक वर है, और जहां भी आजाद रूह की झलक पड़े समझना वो मेरा घर है.
Wow. Very deep.
Yeah, this is very deep. I'll send you. All of them will be sent to you on mail. So this Amrita Pritam talks about in 1940s about women she wants to see and wants to become.
Exactly.
And Ajad Ruh, independent spirited woman, she thought about it in pre-partition days. So I thought you talked about the relocation and Bombay Delhi. That's why it was fitting in. So we have to.
I hope that there are both men and women out there who can find that something that resonates with them.
Yes, yes. And now let's come to the hard part. So the first merger done, and since you were studying and you came and you are the merger acquisition partner who understands. Now let's talk about the work. And in last 2 years, much has changed in the world. And we keep on talking about litigation, that how litigation through technology has happened, what are the handicaps, how it has facilitated, how councils from across the world can appear in matters, a lot of controversy, non-controversy, opening up of the courts. Nobody ever talked about how the transactions are happening, how this 8% or 9% economy, which has bounced back in last 16, 18 months, where India was written off in 2020, June, July. And certainly now everybody is talking about 55,000 or 60,000 stock exchange or the sixth biggest economy taking a V-shaped curve. I know you have a lot to talk about this journey of boardrooms on Zoom and how without touch and feel, economic activities actually took place. So give us a few examples, few interesting times which you had in your comfort of your home or from work from home, and how did that trigger and this untold story you need to share now?
Well, I think thank you for that. And I would say the last 2 years professionally have been the busiest of my life. And I'm sure that there are many, many lawyers out there who would have said the same thing. I know, I'm very grateful that I'm in a position where I can make a statement like that, because there were a number of professions that just got wiped out overnight with the pandemic. We were actually able to move seamlessly into work from home overnight, much before the national lockdown was actually announced. And as I said, technology played a big part. But I think mindset-wise, adaptability was very strong in terms of we have to do it and there's a commitment to getting something done. And I think that culture really helped us over the last year and a half. We saw that in our client community also. We saw that with our competitors, with our people. Deal activity was at an all-time high. There were, of course, other practices that had cyclical movements, but there was cash everywhere. Geopolitical, factors played a big part in India at some point being a sort of goldmine for M&A activity.
Wow.
So I think, there was a lot of interest being shown in the Indian economy. I think some sectors also consolidated, and obviously in any crisis, lawyers always find themselves very useful. So professionally, I would say the last 2 years have, been extremely busy. I think people did take time to understand, how do you train your team? How do you get your team members to be most efficient? How, without sitting across the table, without the body language element, do you really negotiate? But at the same time, I think it pushed people to collaborate. We were doing things together that we would have, frankly, been sitting at our own desks and doing at some point of time. So a new way of working.
And a lot of new people would have joined you in that time, because in my office, I think half of the new recruits I've never met them physically. I just saw them after the second lockdown in Delhi. So recruitments also happened in this time.
There was a big talent buzz because, for some, we didn't stop hiring.
You didn't?
We didn't. I mean, of course, there was a lot of disruption in the talent market because there were other factors that came up. And I think, you're aware as we are that I think burnouts, some of the stresses that especially through the second wave, I think a lot of families got affected. Right. So we did see talent churn.
Hmm.
But, at the same time, growth was happening. We are thinking very consciously about the fact that you're bringing in a generation of lawyers for whom office is going to look very different from the way we have experienced it.
But I think I'll just pause you here that this is very exciting. That's why I'm interrupting you. Sorry for that. That innovation and role of technology much before this pandemic was something which Cyril Amarchand was associated with. And innovation and role of technology, I know one of my friends worked there and she was one of the big instrument. I know how much bullish she is on technology and innovation. But this was like you had understood how the future is going to look like and you prepared yourself. How much technology movement had happened before 2020?
Actually, I think what happened in the last 2 years was 2050 came in 2020. So we fast-tracked almost 20, 30 years of legal innovation into the last 1.5 years. And I still think, as there's not a lot of technology solutions out there for what the profession can actually look like, but at least there was a base, right? So, can you work remotely? Can you collaborate and do documentations, online courts? And as I said, I think adaptability as a mindset was there. But, as a firm, we've adopted that culture for a while now and we've prided ourselves in, sort of being ahead of the curve on this. At some point, this was going to happen. I think the pandemic just crystallized that moment a lot faster than the rest of the world. But so I think people were prepared. I don't think people were thrown off balance because of that. They were used to that culture.
Right.
And even now when we recruit, we are looking for people who are comfortable working in an environment in which disruption is going to be common, in which technology is going to be a sort of bread and butter for how you work, and innovation as a mindset. So innovation doesn't mean you just come up with an app, but are you willing to work differently if the situation requires?
Yeah. And I tell you, in my office, two of my partners who are with me for almost 10 years now, they just walked in and they said, one thing, if we just don't tell you how to log in, you can't even access a courtroom because you're so technologically challenged and you will simply collapse because the courts are not opening up. So I realized that you have to really improve. And when I see judges, Paridhi, judges have become so good. I was just watching that day, Justice Chandrachud and others in the Supreme Court, they are so good with their computer systems. It's so heartwarming to see the kind of effort they are putting in. And
I would say it wasn't easy for me as well in the beginning, and I'm sure my team members will understand. We're so used to hand markup on so many things, either post-it lagao, and how do you do all of this digitally? You know, how do you sit across the table and explain your bad handwriting to somebody? So, you know, all of those things also suddenly became digital. But I think there was a lot of support from people around. People wanted to do this, and I think that really helped.
Yeah, that's the problem here also, because a lot of comfort is there. Even if I see personally, even the younger counsels and the young lawyers, they want this complete camera thing to be there. Let's talk about the practices for Sri Lamachan and for the country in general. Which are the new legal practices you are bullish and you put your money on? And why do you think that these are the areas, like crypto, suddenly it came like last year we were advising and others were also advising. Certainly it has become advertisement number one. So which are the practice areas you are looking at as a corporate lawyer?
Okay. So I think tech as a practice has been coming in for a while. And I think, again, a lot of this got crystallized, A, because of the way we are working and just a lot of the kind of investments that are coming into India. So I think that... that's of course big, and you know, for that I think our traditional clientele is also going to look very different. After a point, your top 10 clients are going to look very, very different in 10 years than they are today. The other thing which I'm sure you're hearing a lot about is, you know, on sustainability and governance. So that's an area in which we are
I'm very happy about it. In fact, I just want to interrupt you. We did a sustainability report for OP Jindal University, one of the best universities in the country. And first sustainability development report by any university in South Asia.
I just want to say that's kind of spectacular.
Yeah. So that's a good area. And what other areas?
So, of course, I think, a lot of this in terms of, I think, as we go into med tech, I think as we go into agri tech, a lot of this is unregulated.
Yes.
It's a big part of our economy, as in if you look at, you know, the medical community, if you look at agriculture, it's a big part of our community, but a lot of it is unregulated for what is going to come.
Yes.
And I think as businesses innovate, I think we will regulate, alongside, if I can say so.
Yes.
I think there's a lot of work that's happening in the regulatory space. Reforms are being put in place by the government, and these are all sort of long-term reforms. But I think side by side, a lot of, you know, sort of day-to-day acts, notes, etc., will be something that we will see as a way of legislating, because everything is evolving all the time. I think we will need to have that flexibility to you know, sort of take into account industry needs and the economy's needs on that.
And we are almost at the last stage. And then just tell me one thing, that sustainability, it's something very personal to you. You have made some good, very bold LinkedIn releases with regard to the, you feel that in oceans, what we should be doing, or ports, what we should be doing. And that's very futuristic. And that's what the regime will look like on sustainability. I'm personally thinking about it for the last 20 years, and now I can see it has been mainstreamed. But you are one of the first person who started saying that what large corporations can do, what Europe has done, what America has done. Similarly, as a developing country or a large economy, India also has to get out of that, that expecting government and NGOs alone to do. You expect the large corporations to be the climate warriors of future. Now, what is your take on carbon neutrality and going on that road, which our Prime Minister also said in Glasgow?
Well, I think India, and I would say a couple of other economies in as well, I think our challenges are unique. I think we have on one side a very deep problem on poverty. We are dealing with a lot of parts of the country that have never been lit up.
Yes.
And we have still not solved for a lot of access, sort of connectivity for the country. And it's a massive country.
Yes.
At the same time, I think just given our sheer size, I think we would be contributing a lot to the conversation around sort of climate change and sustainability.
Yeah.
So I think it's inevitable. I think at some point we would be probably, sort of leapfrogging on this one ahead of many economies if we get our strategy right.
So,
and I believe that till now the dialogue has been a more activist-driven conversation,
yes,
with more governments and sort of NGOs driving, yeah, the agenda. I think that's going to change. People are incorporating this as part of their business model. Some have been compelled. Some have adapted their mindset.
Yes.
But the winds of change have started blowing.
Yes.
And if you want access to the right capital, the right people, the right, customer base, it's going to happen. So I think if you stop treating this like an us versus them problem and look at it as a national agenda, which I think we are, I think we're slowly, slowly moving in that direction, and we regulate for it correctly and we, finance it correctly, I think we would really be going down a very successful path on this. But I think we have to be balanced, and I think for that we will have to be fair. We will have to take inputs. I think we will also have to not try and take a Western solution and just,
yes,
copy paste it in India. It has to be contextualized for the country's need.
Yes, well said. And these are very deep points which you are making. Banks have started talking about it, that will be part of the term sheet, the pro-sustainability, pre-positioning of sustainability is the answer, and mainstreaming it. That's what we should all be working toward. Last question, you read a lot. What are you currently reading?
Well, I'm reading a book called Gachar Gochar, actually. I've just started it. And I have just actually started reading it on the Kindle. So again, I'm trying my best to see if I can use technology for reading as well. I like the touch and feel of paper.
Yeah, me too.
I'm trying this, and it's not bad. It gives me a lot of flexibility. I can read in the middle of the night. It's a good book. I think it's still I'm still in the first initial pages, but it's got my interest.
Right. Wonderful talking to you, Paridhi. You have any questions from me?
Yes, I do. I'm not going to let you get away so quickly. So I have a question, and I would like you to be honest. So if you had to bring somebody from the past onto your show, and past means it could be anywhere, any country, and somebody whether in the profession or outside of the profession, who you would not be able to call in this zamana, so who would you call? And what would be your first question?
I can't give you an honest answer because...
You have to. This is part of the ESG agenda, governance.
Because the honest answer will be not politically correct, but I can tell you very, very difficult question this. I don't know. I want to say a name, but I can't ask.
Okay, so you give us a politically correct answer.
Yeah, I can give you a politically off the cover. I'll tell you there are 2-3 great names in my mind, historical and our gods also. A lot of things come to my mind. I can ask them the reality actually about many things what they are credited with. But anyway, I will give you a. So I will be very happy to interact with John Ilya. He was a shire whom I adore. My entire room has all his pictures. All the walls, everything is about him. So John Ilya he's called the Jim Morrison. He was born in India and migrated to Pakistan. He's no more. And there are unimaginable meanings of all his shayari. And I want to actually meet him because all his videos are so amazing, like you see them and you go in some other world. He's theater, he's all theater. And Mr. Parag Tripathi introduced me to John Ilya, and I almost listen to him or watch him. So I love to interact with him and understand what is life, what is emotion, what is love as per him. And that is what I'll be excited with.
Phenomenal answer.
Very difficult question, Paridhi. Yes,
correct answer for sure.
But I'm so happy you asked this question, and thanks a lot for coming on this show and being such a spectacular, limitless Paridhi. And I'm only going to say that if you think about sustainability, bigger things you'll plan in future, anything which our entire ecosystem can help you with, we all will be there for you. Do well in life.
We have to be in this together.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much, and
do very well. Do very well. Take care. Bye-bye. wonderful talking to you.